A very warm welcome to all the participants, and thanks to Vikram for welcoming me. So this is the lecture that is of on the Google Earth Engine for water resource management. Some of the participants has already working on the GIS and remote sensing based software like QGIS, ArcGIS, ESRI, and some of you might working on the water resource hydrology segment like hydrological modeling, soil loss analysis, reservoir sedimentation analysis. So for most of the water resource analysis, we need some kind of GIS and remote sensing software. So what we do, basically we do, we just download the software, we download the data set, and we perform our analysis. To overcome this, in recent past, I can say to 5 to 6 years, Google Earth Engine is emerging a very user-friendly thing. And because, first of all, it is an open source platform. It is free and open source. Like, that means anyone can use it without any restriction. Apart from commercial use, anybody can use it for their research purpose, for their publication matter, and anything else. Secondly, it is totally the open source. That means you can, it is totally flexible according to the user user demand. That means if you want to do this, only this kind of analysis, so you don't have to learn each and everything about the Google Earth Engine. You just learn about your basic target which you want to study. So basically in this session, I'm going to tell you about what is the Google Earth Engine and how you can use this platform for analyzing any problem related to water resources management. And at the end of the lecture, I will show you some of case studies which I perform with the help of this Google Earth Engine, and some of the basic tasks which traditionally we used to do in some GIS software which requires some time, and with the help of Google Earth Engine we can just do it quickly. And at the end of that case study, I'll just tell you a basic demonstration of one of the platforms which I have developed, and another some of these codes and script how you can basically use this Google Earth Engine platform. Okay, so let me start. So first of all, the basic thing difference between the Google Earth and the Google Earth Engine. So most of the participants might be confused. Those who are not very familiar with the Google Earth Engine, they might be get confused what the Google Earth with the Google Earth Engine. So initially, let me clear you the difference between that. That Google Earth is nothing but a 3D globe visualization software. With the help of Google Earth, you can only visualize some of the data. While Google Earth Engine is a totally separate platform which is generally used for geospatial analysis. Google Earth and Earth Engine are two separate technologies focused on solving separate problems. Okay. Secondly, Google Earth is a rich 3D base map on which raster and vector data can be overlaid. So those who have worked on the Google Earth, not the Earth Engine, but the Google Earth, can see that they can overlay their vector like KML, shapefile, or the raster data over the Google Earth, and they can visualize their spatial variability with reference to the Google Earth. While the Google Earth Engine enables the processing of massive amounts of raster and vector data. Like in Google Earth, you cannot perform any raster based calculation or raster based analysis. It is generally for only visualization purpose. But Google Earth Engine, it enables the user to process the massive amount of data of raster or vector or any other format which is related to some geospatial technologies. And lastly, GEE, that is Google Earth Engine, produces variety of output such as tiles for 2D interactive maps, tables, video, images that can be displayed on the Google Earth. Like the output of this Google Earth Engine, which can be in a raster format, vector, table, images, videos also, it all, most of the things can be overlaid to in the Google Earth just for the viewing purpose. So I think most of you, those who have a confusion, those who are hearing the word the first time, the Google Earth Engine, might get clear concept that Google Earth Engine is a separate technology with regards to the Google Earth. So what is the Google Earth Engine? So according to the definition, Google Earth Engine combines a multi-petabyte catalog of satellite imagery and geospatial data sets with planetary scale analysis capabilities and make it available for scientists, researchers, and developers to detect changes, map trends, quantify differences on Earth surface. As you can see, I've highlighted some of the important terminology in the definition, like it has a multi-petabyte catalog. Like anyone has heard about the 1 GB pen drive, 1 TB, then it is 1 GB. After 1 GB, the 1000 GB combines become 1 PT, that is petabyte. So the Google Earth Engine platform has multi petabyte, like 5 to 7 or more than that petabyte of data set, which consists of satellite imaging and some geospatial data sets like vector data with planetary scale analysis. Like planetary scale means it contains the data set of whole planet, of whole world. It is not only focused on India, it is not only focused on some US or European space agencies. It focuses on each and every corner of the globe. Planetary scale analysis capabilities make it available for scientists, research and developers. Means apart from the commercial purposes, all the scientists, researchers and developers are free to use this data set and this platform to detect the changes, map trends and quantify differences. Like if you have some historic data, what we generally do, we just find out the differences, change detection. We just analyze some water resources or some vegetation, forest analysis on the Earth surface. So basically they have some satellite images, you generate your algorithm, and lastly it will create some real world applications which you can apply into your research domain or water resource. Maybe if you are from water resource segment, forestry or any other, you can apply your particular algorithm and create your own real world application. So what is a Google Earth Engine? It is a remote sensing archive with petabyte of data in one location. A cloud-based geospatial processing platform for executing large dataset analysis. Why it is saying that only one location? Suppose if you want to do some analysis on Landsat data, I think most of the people who have worked on the remote sensing and GIS are maybe heard about the Landsat data. So to download the Landsat data, you have to go to USGS website. Okay, so if you want to analyze same thing in on different data set, like on Sentinel. So Sentinel basically available on European Space Agency platform, but now it is also available on USGS. But Earth Engine is a platform which provides all those freely available data set in one location. Second, it is a cloud-based geospatial processing platform for executing large-scale data set. As you said, that it is a cloud-based geospatial processing platform. So that means it is not the desktop-based. You don't have to install anything in your computer. You don't have to rely on your good hardware requirement. Like those who are working on the GIS and the geospatial technologies, on the traditional software like ISRI ArcGIS and QGIS. So you know that to install those software, you need some good hardware and software support of your computer. Like it has to be minimum 4 to 6 GB RAM. The external capacity should be more than 5 GB and certainly like that. But if you want to work on the Google Earth Engine, you don't have to need any some good software or a good computer. You just need a small computer which has a web browser in it. Okay, so why it is such a powerful image analysis software? So this is the basically the software architecture, simplified system architecture diagram, how the Google Earth Engine works. So with the help of code editor and third-party web apps, the client with the help of JavaScript and Python interact with the Google Earth Engine through REST API. And after some creating some query over this with the help of REST API, the front end of these system will compute your processing in the batch computation. Like parallelly, it will compute many algorithms in many images parallelly, so that the result will be available in very few seconds. So it has a public data catalog, vast amount of public available data. You don't need to store any data. That means you don't need to download any data set into your computer. You just call the data set like Landsat, Sentinel, any other data set, and you just apply your algorithm over data set on your web browser only. It has a very massive processing power, computation engine. I will show you some small demonstration that how it is powerful in computation process. It has an interactive development platform. Like it is available on two platforms, that is JavaScript and Python. Save and share work routines. Like in a traditional GIS software, you need something extra license to share your work when you are working in the ISRI ArcGIS or QGIS. In the QGIS, you need to install any third party amount software to share your work with some other client or some other thing. But with the help of Google Earth Engine, you just simply can share your work just by simply a single click. So at the end of this, the basic introduction, there's a question arises, why should we use Google Earth Engine when we have already done traditional good ArcGIS and QGIS or any other software? So first of all, it is a planetary scale science. That means it does not focus on only on one area or one specific country. It focuses on the whole planet. Second, it is freely available cloud processing with built-in functions. You don't have to create your, what we can say, your create your any means. You don't have to rely on other outside the data sets. Secondly, thirdly, it has a massive online public data archive. Like most of the data set that are freely available by US space agencies, European Space Agency, JAXA, and other space agencies that are publicly available in the USGS website or another website are freely available in the Google Earth Engine platform. And the most important thing, you can upload your own data. It has a massive online public data archive. That doesn't mean that you can work only on that data set. You can upload your own data set. It can be a vector, it can be a raster. It has a flexible access through APIs. There are two APIs, that is JavaScript and Python. So most of the geospatial technologies are already working on Python. So if you have some basic knowledge of Python, you can easily work, continue with the work on Google Earth Engine, either through QGIS or Jupyter Notebook or any other Python program, any other Python platform. Or if you are very comfortable in the JavaScript, so you can work on the JavaScript also. You don't need to install anything. So those who are not very familiar with the programming, they don't have to worry that you have to learn some new programming language. When you're working with a JavaScript, it has a very what we can say, very friendly interface when you are working with a JavaScript. There are lots of documentation that are available. So it is very, I don't say that it's a very complicated exercise to work on the JavaScript and Python. Later on, you will just get to know at the end of this demonstration. So when I was talking about the public data catalog, so most of you have heard about the Landsat 4, 5, 7, 8. So if you want to analyze something on Landsat 8 and the same thing analysis on Landsat 5, so what you have to do, you have to download the Landsat 5 and 8 separately. Then you, if you're downloading some raw data, then you have to convert into TOA, that top of atmospheric correction. Then you have to convert into surface reflectance. But the Earth Engine provides all of these data sets in one go. Like it is it provides you Landsat 4 to 8, then not only as surface reflectance data, but raw data, top of all the available Landsat data that are publicly available are can get with the help of Google Earth Engine. Not only Landsat, but the MODIS product, like MODIS multispectral data, and not only the satellite data, but the satellite product like soil moisture and MODIS ED and MODIS NDVI are also available, land surface temperature, in the Earth Engine platform. The terrain data, the most important thing for water resource analyst is the DEM. So if you want to analyze something like if you want to delineate any watershed, so what you will do, you just go to the any platform to download the DEM, and you have to download the separate types. But if you want, you can just, if you don't want to analyze and don't want to analyze something, but you just only want to download the data, Google Earth Engine will provide that also, that you can just download the various terrain data like SRTM, GeoTopo, Aster, and many other DM data. Then already, as I told you, the land cover data, many satellite product like globe cover, NLCD, and many other LULC map are available. Many atmospheric data like temperature, precipitation of various platform are available in the Google Earth Engine. So it has more than the 200 public data sets available daily or every week. There are some new images will be uploaded, like latest images, like if I say about CHIRPS, rainfall data. So in every week, you can get the latest CHIRPS satellite data. Then it has more than 5 million of images. It has greater than 5 petabytes of data. So this is just in a small screenshot of how the JavaScript components, the components of the Earth Engine editor that work on the JavaScript. So later on, I will just show you how the things work. So basically, you can see that this is the map in which you can display your result, your output. This is the output console panel, and this is the area which where you write your codes. So generally, this I have to tell you that there are two types of API, that is JavaScript API and Python API. Most of you are working in the Python already. So what is the difference if you want to start with a Google Earth Engine? So there is always a question that I should start with a JavaScript or Python. So there are some differences in when you are using some JavaScript and Python. First is JavaScript has a rich documentation and tutorials. Like Google Earth Engine in their own website has some good documentation available when you are working in the JavaScript. But when it comes to Python, there are only limited documentation and tutorials available from their official platform. Secondly, JavaScript code editor, it is easy to get started. That means you don't need to install anything. You don't need to what we can say install any library. It is just you just log in into your account and it just can easy to get started. But on the other hand, Python, you need to install any Python library, or you can say Python ideally. But to overcome that, you can use the Google Colab. Those who are working in the Python may already know about the Google Colab. So with the help of Google Colab, you don't need to install anything. You don't need to install any library. So this can overcome with the help of Google Colab. But Python has an easier language syntax. So those who are not very much familiar with the programming, they can start with the help of Python, because Python, to learn Python is very much easy. As I'm, my background is civil engineering, and I can tell you from my personal experience that if you want to learn programming, if you want to start programming, you can go with the help of Python, not only with the Google Earth Engine, but for any other purposes, like for a standalone water resource application, for a standalone geospatial application, you can rely on the Python. So it has, JavaScript has built-in interactive mapping functionality, which Python doesn't have. It has built-in authentication. You can create Earth Engine apps, but the disadvantage is that you cannot install any additional package. But when it comes to the Python, it has, as already told you, that it has easier language syntax. It is easy to share code between the scripts. Like if you want to share your code, you can easily done that. This advantage is also available in the JavaScript also. Batch processing. It has a very good advantages of batch processing. Like in their website of Google Earth, it is strongly recommend not to use loop in the JavaScript. But if you are using in the Python, you can easily make batch processing tools for creating some large amount of processing. It has more IDs with debugging capabilities. Like there are n number of ID means Python platform in which you code your Python code, like PyCharm, IDLE, Google Colab, Notebook. There's many other Python IDs which also provide you debugging capabilities. There are numerous Python packages. Like there are n number of Python packages which can be used on Google Earth Engine data directly or indirectly. Though it doesn't have any built-in interactive mapping functionality in Python, but as I say that it has numerous Python packages available to display your data set to charts in plotting. So you can use that thing in plotting and visualization options. It has integration with open source GIS. Like as you can see that those who are working on the QGIS or ArcGIS, so those GIS platform are built on Python mainly. So if you want to interact with that platform on the Google Earth Engine data, you can use that Python API to interact with some open source GIS software. So how does it work? So first of all, what you can do with the help of Google Earth Engine, like you can get a simply an image, like in the format of web map, KML and GeoDiff format. You can pick your projection, your resolution, particular, your bands, mounting box visualization. And after getting an image, you can apply a small algorithm if you want to apply, like if you want to calculate the NDVI. NDVI is nothing but a small algorithm, a small mathematical algorithm on two separate bands of that particular image. So you can apply that over your image. now filter your collection. Like if you have a n number of data sets, if I tell you about from Landsat 7, so from 1990 to 2013, there are n number of Landsat images. If you want to select only few, you can filter your collection with some functionalities. If you want to apply algorithm all over the selected image, you can just do by just simply two or three lines of code, and you can reduce your collection to your some particular area, and you can compute the aggregate. For example, the rainfall data available on the daily basis. So if you want to get the aggregate, yearly aggregate of rainfall data, you can just simply click you just simply create those data set with just few amounts of a few line of code, and you can perform some basic vector operation. So as it is not a complete GIS solution, that you don't you cannot perform various detailed vector analysis, but most of the raster based analysis processing can be happen in the Google Earth Engine. So now this is all about the basics. What is the Google Earth Engine and how the Google Earth Engine can overcome the basic traditional software which are using in GIS and what is the segment. Now I'm going to talk about some case studies which I have done, because more technical detail could not be tell about the Google Earth Engine with the help of slides. You just learn about the Google Earth Engine by just performing on it. Okay, so first of all, in order to start with the Google Earth Engine, you should know that what kind of work, when you're working on the water resource segment, what kind of work you can do with the help of this Google Earth Engine. So I'm going to present some of my case studies. So this is an example of can you hold for 1 minute? So it is examples of large data processing with just few lines of code. So if I ask you to get the long-term annual rainfall of whole Madhya Pradesh, if you want to get the rainfall or annual rainfall from 30 or to 40 years of any particular area like Madhya Pradesh whole or whole Maharashtra or whole India, so what your traditional technique will do? How do you will do with the help of satellite image? Can anybody response me? If your mic is on,
yes sir, mic is on.
Okay, so can anybody tell me that if I give you a target, a small exercise, that you extract the rainfall amount, this yearly amount of any particular state of 40 years with the help of satellite images, so how will you do that? Those who have already worked on rainfall data set, can anybody respond?
Yes.
Can you tell me what will be your approach to get this type of information? Okay, I think most of you might not
have. Audible?
Yes.
I have used CRU data sets.
Okay, so what will your approach? You just download the data set, I think.
Yeah, and use Thiessen Polygon.
Okay, you just use a Thiessen Polygon, and if you want to download, if the data set is available yearly, then you have to make some computing average and some summation over the GIS software.
Statistical method is
needed. Yes. So this needs a lots of exercises. Like you have to, first of all, you have to download the data set. Then you have to apply the Thiessen Polygon of your own area. Then you have to make the summation of each month or each year or each day. But with the help of Google Earth Engine, I will show you at the end of the, just with the help of few lines, I just create the huge amount of data set with the help of some just few lines of code. So this is the benefit of this Google Earth Engine, that you can directly work on the satellite images but by just basic knowledge of some programming languages. Now another example is this surface water indices. Like most of who was working on the geospatial data set and water resource analysis, they know about the NDWI or NDVI, that is normalized differential water index. Then the advanced version of NDVI, NDWI is MNDWI, and the advanced version of this MNDWI is WNI. So if I tell you that calculate the NDWI of whole India, so what will your approach? You first download the Landsat 8 scene of whole India, which I think might contain more than 700 or 800 scenes, which covering whole over the India. Then after the downloading those data set, you just combine this data set with the tile mosaicing, and after tile mosaicing you just need to clip your data set with a shape file, and after clipping you just need to go to any GIS software or ADAS Imagen or QGIS to apply the NDWR algorithm, that is green minus SWR, just the formula with that. Then after that you will get this NDWR. But with the help of Google Earth Engine, in just 5 to 6 line of codes and some shapefile of India, you can quickly get the NDWI. And by just changing a small band number, you can easily get the MNDWI, NDWI, or any other N number of indices which are available in the remote sensing protocol. And by just providing another shapefile of, if you want, don't want to work on whole over India, if you want to work on maybe some another country, you just need to provide the shapefile of your area. And you just by a few clicks, a few lines of code, you can create your this huge amount of data sets with just few minutes. So this is very much what you can say advantages when you're working on huge data set. So another case study which I'm going to tell you about, the rainfall runoff modeling using the SCS curve number method. So basically, what is SCS curve number method and what is the rainfall runoff modeling? I think those who are working on the water resource segment might know that. To generate runoff from the rainfall data is known as the rainfall runoff modeling, and there is a method known as SCS curve number method. In this method, the remote sensing input are required, like for LULC you need some LULC product like Landsat or any other LISTRI data. For soil data you need some NBLS, NBSS or FAO data. Then you need the rainfall data, and by combining these three data sets and by using some equation, you can able to calculate the surface runoff. So in order to do that, what we'll do, we just first download the Landsat data and we prepare the LULC map, or we can just directly download the LULC map of MODIS or etc. Then we have to download the soil data from either from NBSS or FAO, and we have to get the rainfall data either from stations or from the satellite data. Anybody seeing anything? Okay, so after downloading the data set, what you will do, you just create the curve number map. So curve number depend on the LULC and soil map. So you need some GIS software, and then you need to convert the raster into vector, and then with the help of vector you will need to create the curve number, and with the help of AMC condition, like on the that depend on the rainfall data, you need to create the AMC1, AMC2 and AMC3 conditions. And according to that condition, you will calculate the surface retention, that is S, and with the help of this S, you will calculate the surface runoff of your particular area. And if you want to do this analysis for another area, you have to do the similar exercises whole again, from ending to some beginning to ending. Like you have to download the data set secondly, and you have to perform this analysis either in some GIS software or with the help of Excel or some other spreadsheet. But with the help of Google Earth Engine, we can do this rainfall runoff modeling of any area. Like this I have done of this might be done from of whole world, and you can check your result for particular segment of area. So this is the study that we have performed over the Tawa Reservoir, Tawa Basin, and not only for Tawa Basin. Once I have created the code, I can do this analysis by any n number of basins, n number of district level, or any area of this whole world by just few changing in minor changes in the code. So in this study, we have used the soil texture data of Open Landmap soil texture class. Because FAO data presently is not available, but other than FAO, the Open Landmap soil series data is available. You can get the soil texture map of that. And for LULC, you can either create your own land use land cover map with the help of Landsat or Sentinel-2 data. But in present case, I have used the MODIS land use land cover data, which is directly available on the Earth Engine platform. And for the rainfall data, I have use the CHIRPS data, which is the daily rainfall data from 1981 to 2021. And not only I've created the maps, but I've created the graph only in the Earth Engine. That means you don't need to go and at the end of this study, I've compared my data set with the available data set, that at how much interval or at how much level my data or my analysis is accurate. So if you're working on the Earth engine, you don't need to rely on any other software. Like for visualization purposes, you can totally rely on the Google Earth engine. So another case study that I have done is on the soil loss estimation using Uselane. So most of those who have worked on the water resource segment might know about the soil losses analysis. So there are various equations to calculate the soil loss, like Uselane, that is universal soil loss equation, Uselane model, MMF model. So what does the Uselane model do? So it, with the help of some soil data set, rainfall data set, DEM, land use map and slope map, you will create them different factor maps like K factor, R factor, LS, P, C factor. And after creating this all factors map, and by just simply calculation, by mathematical simple multiplication, we calculate the soil loss map in the particular unit. So if you want to do this type of modeling, so for what you have to do, first you have to download the soil data set, then you have to download the rainfall, then you have to download the DEM, and you have to create the land use map, slope map, and flow accumulation map. And after those creating those maps, you will, at the end of this analysis, you will create the K factor map, which knows about the soil properties, R factor map, LS factor map, P factor map, C factor map. And by multiplication on the raster calculator, you will get the soil loss. So as you see that it requires, so though the processing is very easy, but it is a very lengthy process that you have to download the data set, you have to create the similar kind of condition like projection system, the pixel values, sorry, pixel resolution, it has to be the same, then only you will able to calculate the soil loss. And if you want to perform the same work on another region, like if I calculated the Uselane with a traditional approach GIS software or some Madhya Pradesh, if I want to calculate the same thing, the same calculation for Maharashtra, then again I have to start from the beginning, and I have to download the data set, I have to calculate all the factors, and with the help of Uselane model. But with the help of Earth Engine, I've just created a simple code, and by just changing the shape files or by just changing some few lines, I can get the soil loss of any part of this India or any part of this world. And not only I will get the simple soil loss map, I can get the statistics. Like in this, I have calculated the soil loss of Mahi Basin. It is located at the boundary of Rajasthan and Gujarat, and I can see that 32% of this Mahi Basin have the slight soil loss, and few percent of this Mahi Basin are experiencing very, very severe soil loss. And not only for whole basin, but I have calculated the separate classes of those. Like in Mahi Basin, there are total 265 sub basins. And not only for whole over Mahi Basin, I can able to calculate the soil loss parameters of all of the 265 basins. And I can get the mean of total area, and I can get this interactive chart. And once I have developed this code for Mahi Basin, I need not to develop another code for another area. I just need to change my shapefile, change my AOI, and I can get the soil loss or another area. So this is one more example. The previous two examples I have done with the help of JavaScript. So now this is another application that I have developed, that is the watershed delineation app. So what is the traditional method of delineating watershed? You just download the DEM and you will provide the outlet point, and you will delineate your watershed. It sometimes requires a good computational system and huge amount of time also. But with the help of Earth Engine datasets available, I have developed an app in which you can delineate your watershed in just few clicks. So in this application, I have used the Earth Engine app to delineate the watershed. It uses the WWF Hydroshed basin level data. That is a website which provides the dataset. And the data set is available in the Google Earth Engine. And I've used the Python API with some other powerful libraries like LumPy, Pandas, IPy widgets, Gmap. As I have told you, the advantages of Python is that you can use some another third-party libraries. You can which can directly or indirectly interact with the Earth Engine dataset. So the Earth Engine dataset is this HydroSheds basin level dataset, and I have interact this dataset. I have applied some processing technique using NumPy, Pandas, and Gmap library on this dataset. And at the end of the product is that. You just user can delineate a watershed by defining an outlet point, and the KML file of watershed can be accessed via the link generator of this website. So I will show you the demo at the end of this lecture of this website. Now, this is one more example which can be done either in Python or in JavaScript. So not only some static information you can do, but you can do perform some dynamic analysis also. So in this case, I'm using the Landsat and JRC global surface water mapping data. So this I have data I've done on the Bhopal Lake. So as you can see in this map, this is the surface water occurrence map of Bhopal Lake. This is the very prior source of drinking water of whole of the Bhopal city, which contains the population approximately 20 lakhs people. So you can see that the water occurrence range is 100% over this region and the 0% in this region. That means the availability of water throughout this 30 years, it's 100% over this region and 0% over this region. And I can create some summary of transition class area. Like in this whole water body, the 30% of the water body is permanent. And the 33% of this water body is seasonal. And by like this, you can create your own, or you can get some own analysis, analysis of your own area. If you're working in Maharashtra or any other area, or if you want to analyze some surface water, like in the past 30 years, what was the availability of surface water, lake ponds, you can directly analyze those data set. Or those areas with the help of GRC global surface water mapping. In this map, you can see that it is the intra-annual water map. The value of this pixel is 12 and the value of this area is 0. That means area of this water body is available in 12 season, the 12 month of particular year. While this, when we are going from east to west, the water availability is decreasing because this portion is generally the seasonal water is available. And not only that, I can visualize the NDWI map because I have used the Landsat data. And this is the surface water transition map of Upper Lake. That means this area is the permanent lake. That means whether it is summer, winter, or rainy season, this area of Upper Lake will get the water throughout the season. So this is just the water spread area and the, or we can say the surface water dynamics of whole Bhopal city. Okay, so another study which I have done in the, that means the land use dynamics of Bhopal city. So those who don't want to work on the water resource, they just want to calculate the supervised classification, unsupervised classification, or those who are working in the forest field, they can also do various kind of analysis. So in this study, what I have done, I have calculated the land use dynamics of the Bhopal city. So I have used the Landsat data of 1990, 1999, 11, 2011, and 2018, and I've classified the this water what we can say. I've classified the whole Bhopal city into 5 classes. They build up water body vegetation, and with the help of machine learning techniques that are already available in the Google Earth Engine. There's one more technique, which is CART. It is a supervised classification technique. And with the help of this technique, I've classified this various decadal maps. And I have also calculated the overall accuracy and Kappa coefficient for accuracy assessment. Those who have already worked on the supervised classification on ADAS, imagine or ArcGIS, and they just need to depend on the accuracy measurement like Kappa coefficient, overall accuracy, producer accuracy to check the data set and to check the supervised classification technique. But the Google Earth Engine provide all the things in their platform. And not only then one machine learning algorithm, but apart from this, there are n number of techniques of supervised, unsupervised classification, which you can adopt in your store area. So these are the results which I've created of land use dynamics of Bhopal city. In this, I see that in 2018, the settlement, that is the urban settlement area, has been increased, and the forest vegetation area is decreased. So this kind of statistics and maps can be generated with the help of Earth Engine, and not only I just doing my work unchecked. I've checked my data set with the help of some accuracy measurement like Kappa coefficient and overall accuracy, and I get the accuracy of very good amount, that is 0.88 and 0.99, which is a very good accuracy in terms of classification. Then not only some you can perform analysis only with the help of optical data, but with the help of microwave data, you can perform various analysis. Like this is a case study which was performed by Varun Tiwari, one of my colleagues and friend. He has done some mapping on 2018 Kerala, and with the help of Sentinel-1 microwave image, they have created some how the flood inundation has occurred throughout, from the starting of the flood season to end of this flood season. So now those who are not familiar with the Python installation, they can directly work on the Google Earth QGIS platform also. Like in the QGIS, there is a plugin available known as Google Earth Engine. Just need to install that plugin, and whatever the code you are writing in the Python API, you can just directly write in the QGIS platform. So this is an example of Google Earth Engine Python API with a Jupyter notebook, how you can write your Python API Python code with the help of Earth Engine like this. When you are working with the Earth Engine, you just need to call the library known as import EE, that's it, import Earth Engine, and with the help of some other libraries also, I have created some good maps and application. So this is all about the basics of Google Earth Engine. Now I will tell you a small, what you can say, small demonstration how you can do some analysis in Google Earth Engine. So this is just the small demonstration. It is not the tutorial exercises. If you want some tutorial exercises related to this, you can, we will generally float this kind of exercises training in the future with the help of Albedo Foundation. You just need to check the website and join the courses accordingly. So this is the application that I have developed with the help of Earth Engine and Python. It might take some time because dependability on the internet. So it is an Earth Engine app to delineate the watershed. All these steps to delineate the watershed written here, that select the drainage threshold, higher the number, higher the drainage order. If you go down, you just select the threshold, like this is presently it is 10,000. I just leave it as it is, and I just click on show drainage, and after just few seconds, the drainage area and the drainage line of whole over world will be come in front of you. And if you focus zoom to your area, you can show clearly visualize your own drainage line, river pond, or I can say the river. So the dense drainage are not come up. If you want to see the small drainage, you just need to reduce this threshold and click on show drainage, then you will get some small drainage also. Then after that, choose the outlet point using the draw a marker on the left hand of the panel. So like if you want to draw a Narmada basin at the outlet of this, I don't remember the dam name, there is a very famous reservoir inaugurated by recently. So if you want to delineate the watershed at this outlet, what you will do, you just click this draw marker, place on your outlet point exactly, and click on this create watershed. So as you show, it is showing that delineating, so it might take some few seconds or maybe 1 or 2 minutes. So you can see this, your watershed has been created, and the watershed area of this watershed is 86,960 kilometer square, and you can download the KML file of this watershed from this link. Okay, you just need to copy this link and paste in your web browser. You will be able to download and see. You can visualize the Narmada basin boundary of this your particular area. Okay, so not only Narmada basin, not only very big basin, but for a small basin you can draw your watershed. But there is a limitation of this platform with this, which I have written that this app works fine for the watershed greater than 200 square. So if you want to work on a very small basin, this app may not work very appropriately. Okay, so this is a small demonstration, so this is a small application which I have developed with the help of Earth Engine data sets and some Python libraries. So likewise, if you are working in your respective field, either water sources or any other field, you can create your own application, your own platform to do some basic analysis. Now I will tell you a small part how you can perform some sim exercises with the help of Google Earth Engine JavaScript. So you need to first to create an account. So if you go to this website codeearthengine.eu, you can go to the Google Earth Engine. So first of all, it will tell you to create an account, and while creating your account, they will ask you that your purpose. So you have to be very specific about your purpose, then only they will allow you to create an account. And within few minutes they will tell you that yes, your account has been created. And after your account has been created, you just need to go to this website, that is code.earthengine.google.com. So as you can see, this is the Earth Engine platform. This is the map area. You can drag and extend your map area. This is here code, which area in which you write your code, and these are the different panels. So how the things will work? So these are all the codes which I have already scripts, which I have already created of my work or my experimental purposes. Yeah, if I want to access any of the code, I just click any of the code and I can directly use my code. Okay, after that there's a panel known as docs. In this you can see there are n number of algorithm that is available, or the functionality are available for each and every type of data sets, like e feature collection, that means image shape file. So there are n number of functionality that are available to process on any shape file or any other data sets. So if you want to search for data set, like if you want to search for normalized difference water index, so there is a function known as normalized difference. You can just click on this, read about this functionality, and you can apply this thing in your code. And apart from that, there's a third column is the assets. Asset means your own data set. So like I have created my own data set, my own shape file, because creating a exact shape file might not be possible in the code, because this is not the GIS platform. You cannot perform some vector operations. But you can perform in another GIS software, and you can import the shape file. Like I have imported various shape file for my study, and not only the shape file, you can import the raster file also. Like this, I have imported my raster file and perform with the help of algorithm that are available in the Earth Engine. I perform on this my raster data. Okay, so I think I just tell you a small. How you can import your data set, or how the things will work. Suppose if you want to display the Landsat image, so what you will do, you just for search for Landsat 8. Okay. Okay, so there are various Landsat 8 available, like tier 1, real time, early some data set, raw, TOA. I just click on more. The data set is come here. So if I want to display the top of atmospheric reflections, so I just click on this. Here you will get the description, the band information, like I know that is band 3, band 4, band 5, all these available bands, and the image properties, like what are the different properties that are available for each bands. And if you want to display this data set, either you can copy this code, or what you can do, you just open this thing into another tab. Okay, so it will show you a small code to display the data set. So I just click on this copy and paste in my script panel. So what we are doing, we're just calling the Landsat 8 image from 2017 January to 2017 December, and I'm just selecting the band number 4, 3, and 2, and by just clicking run, I can able to visualize the Landsat images of Landsat 8 images from 2017 of whole 2017 of whole world in a single click. So it might take time to visualize all over the screen because I don't want to display of whole over the world. I just want to display of this particular area, and this particular area. So what I will do, I just create a small boundary, like with the help of this draw rectangle, you can create a small boundary. Okay. So this is the Landsat images of whole world, and here I just simply write a single code, that is filter bounds, and in the bracket I will give this geometry, that means this shape file. And by clicking run again, now you can see the data set is available not of whole the world but for this area only. Okay, so if you want to clip the data set, because this is the data set for whole 2017, in order to clip this data set, you can convert this data set on a single image, like I can do with the help of mean, and after that I will just use clip. You can see my area, my image is clipped only to my area of interest. So this how you can, just by clicking some few, adding some few lines or adding some few words, you can get your data set. So this is the line of 2017. If I want to get the image of 2020 like this, I just have to change the year, and by just single click I will get the image of 2020 only. So this is how you can use this platform, not only some processing. So if you don't want to process any in the Google Earth Engine, but if you want to download the data set, you can do with some adding some few lines of code, and you can display the data sets accordingly. So one more demonstration that I have told you, for the annual rainfall, which I have developed. So this code I have developed to calculate the annual rainfall. So I just click on run. So this is the small area of interest which I've taken, and I can see that from 2000 to 2020 my rainfall data is come up. And if I want to apply this data sets over whole Madhya Pradesh, so what I will do, I will go to my assets. I'm not taking all over the India because it will take more time. I just take my MP boundary, it's Madhya Pradesh. I just click on this. So as you can see, this MP boundaries come up with a table 2. I just click on this table 2 and I click on run. So it will take some more time. So you can see the image, but when we are doing some analysis over rainfall, you don't need to get to an image. But if you want to download this image, I have written the code in such a manner that you can download this average the summation value from 2000 to 2014. If I click on run, it will ask my the path, and the data set will automatically download to my Google Drive. And in this panel you can see the graph has been generated, and I can see the rainfall from 2000 to 2021. In 2021, you can see this only 18 mm rainfall because the rainy season has not come yet. And you can analyze that in the 2013, the rainfall is more than approximately 1600. And I know that in 2019 also the rainfall is quite good. So this is, I have created this graph with the help of CHIRPS data. So not only the CHIRPS data, but there are n number of other data, rainfall data is available. Just click to search and you can get the result according to your own output. So that's it from me. This is just a small glimpse of Earth Engine, the basic functionality, the basic case study that can perform. So most of the GIS exercises, most of the water resources exercises, which are done by some GIS traditional software, can be performed with the help of Earth Engine also. You just need to get started either from JavaScript or Python. So that's it from my side.